compounds of 60 group elements, 16 group elements. So in this 16 group elements, we will discuss O2, dioxygen, and oxides, and then ozone. These are the three compounds of oxygen. Coming to the sulfur, we will discuss SO2 and oxyacids of sulfur. Oxyacids of sulfur. Total 5 compounds we need to discuss. Next, the first one is dioxygen. I think you know about the oxygen. I just give you the important points about the dioxygen, how to prepare, how to easily remember the preparation methods of oxygen. One thing, we can prepare this dioxygen by using chlorate salts, ClO3-. Chlorate salts, nitrate salts, as permanganates or dichromates. Any one of these salts. On decomposition, thermally decompose, we can prepare oxygen gas. That's the first simple trick. For example, potassium chloride, potassium nitrate, potassium permanganate, potassium dichromate. When these salts on heating, thermally decompose and they produce oxygen gas. Simple, easy trick. And the second one, we can prepare by thermally decomposition of metal oxide. Here, is this all metal oxides can we use? No. The metal oxides of less reactive metals. Less reactive metals in the electrochemical series. Hapa, mercury, silver, platinum, gold. Okay, so by using less reactive metal oxides on thermally decomposes, we get oxygen. This is the second method. And the third one, when potassium permanganate or potassium dichromate, any one of these oxidizing agents, this on reaction with concentrated H2SO4, when we treat them with the concentrated H2SO4, we will get oxygen as one of the byproduct. So for example, KNO4H2SO4, what is the reaction? KNO4 reacts with H2SO4, we will get K2SO4, MnSO4 and H2O and O2. Like K2CR2OZone, if you take chromium sulfate and chromium oxide and H2O and O2. Anyhow, we are getting oxygen as one of the byproduct. And the fourth one, by decomposition of H2O2, as we know, H2O2 is highly unstable. Immediately it will be splits into what? H2O and half O2. Okay, or else in the last one, industrially, if you wanted to prepare in bulk amounts, just take the ale. This on fractional distillation. Okay, then pure ale if you take. In that pure ale, oxygen is one of the major component. On fractional distillation, on liquefaction followed by the fractional distillation, we'll get a pure oxygen gas. So these are the 5 methods of preparation of oxygen gas. Next, move to the properties. If you see, I am not going in detail about the properties. Why? Because you know the properties of oxygen very well. You just remember that the solubility, if you just remember, the solubility is 3.08 centimeter cube in 100 centimeter cube of water. It is soluble in the water. If you take 100 ml of water, in 100 ml of water, how many ml of oxygen will be there, 3.08 ml of oxygen will be there, and usually it will be liquefy at 90 kelvins. Okay, oxygen gas liquefy at 90 kelvins and it will be freezes at 55 kelvins. Freezing point is what? 55 kelvin. And liquefaction, at what temperature they start liquefy? 90 kelvins. So this is about the. And generally, when metals are reacts with oxygen, they form their metal oxides. When non-metals on oxidation, on reaction with oxygen, they give non-metal oxides. When hydrocarbons on reaction with oxygen, oxygen will convert the hydrocarbons into carbon dioxide and water. So we know these all properties, that is why I am not going in detail about the properties of oxygen. So this is about the small hint about the oxygen. Next, move to the oxides. Oxides. Yes, how you simply define the oxides? Oxides are nothing but the binary compounds of oxygen with any other elements. Binary means The compound made up with two elements. Out of the two elements, one is oxygen, fixer. The other one may be a metal, non-metal, any one. So that compounds we called as what? Oxides. So oxides are nothing but, these are binary compounds, binary compound of oxygen with any element is called what? Oxides. And these oxides we are classifying into two ways. The first classification, if you see, based on oxygen quantity or oxygen content, how much of oxygen is present in it. Based upon that, we are classifying the oxides into following types. What are those? First one is simple oxides. Next one, polyoxides. Next one, suboxides. And fourth one, mixed oxides. Total four types are simple oxides. Simple oxides means they have as much amount of oxygen that is permitted by their oxidation number. If they have the same amount, then that oxides we call it as simple oxides. Okay, they have exactly the same quantity of oxygen they have, then that oxides we call it as simple oxides. Polyoxides mean they have excess amount of oxygen than their permitted levels. And these polyoxides have three types mainly. That is peroxides. Next one, superoxides. And dioxides. Three types are there. Peroxides means where oxygen is in the form of O2-2 form. Here superoxide means O2-, and dioxide means two oxygens. They won't give any H2O2 on hydrolysis, but O2 will give H2O. Okay, next one, suboxides. They have lesser amount of oxygen than they require. For a best example, carbon suboxide, C3O2. Okay, and the mixed oxides, these are the oxides formed by the combination of two simple oxides. Best example, Fe3O4. Fe3O4 is the combination of FeO and Fe2O3. So this is what best example for mixed oxides. So based upon the quantity of oxygen present in it, oxides of four types: simple, poly, suboxides, and mixed oxides. Then the second classification based on nature of oxides. On the basis of nature, oxides we are classifying into following categories. The first one is acidic oxides. Next one, basic oxides. Next one, amphoteric oxides. And the fourth one, neutral oxides. Acidic, basic, amphoteric, and neutral. Now, acidic oxides means the oxides of non-metals. All non-metallic oxides are what? Acidic in nature. Basic nature means all the oxides of metals are basic. And also you should remember, not always all metals. When the metals having higher oxidation state, okay, when the metal oxides are having high oxidation state, again they show acidic in nature. Okay, so if the metal is having variable oxidation state, for example Mn, you take manganese, it can be exist in Mn+2, Mn+4, Mn+6, Mn+7. Mn+7, if you take, it is the highest oxidation state. So what is the nature of them? Acidic in nature. So that you should not always, oxides of metals are basic, oxides of metals may be acidic also, then if the metal atom is in a highest oxidation state. Next, amphoteric. Amphoteric means the oxides of metalloids. Oxides of metalloids and also oxides of zinc, aluminium and beryllium. Beryllium oxide, aluminium oxide, zinc oxide and all the oxides of metalloids are amphoteric. Amphoteric means they show both acidic and as well as basic. And neutral, out of all oxides, three are there neutral. What are those? N2O is a neutral oxide, NO is one more neutral oxide, and CO is another neutral oxide. Total three oxides which are neutral in nature. They won't be responsible, they won't show both acidic and as well as basic behavior. So these are the types of oxides based upon the nature of them. So this is about the oxides. Then move to the third compound, that is what? Ozone.
we represent this with O3.
As we know, ozone also we called as what? Oxide of oxygen. Yes. As we know, ozone is present in which layer? Stratosphere. Present in stratosphere. And what is the role of them? It prevents control of UV rays coming from the sun radiations. And usually ozone, how to prepare this ozone? Let us see. Preparation, if you see, usually ozone is preparing from oxygen. 3O2 gives rise to 2O3. 3O2 gives rise to 2O3. And but one point you should remember, where del H value was positive. Positive means what? Endothermic. And if it is endothermic, for endothermic reactions, what we need to do? We need to provide supply the heat energy. But here, we should not supply heat to this. Why? Because but as per the thermodynamically, this is what endothermic. Na? For endothermic reactions, supplying the heat or increasing the temperature is favorable. But why not? We should not heat the supply the heat, because in this case, oxygen is thermodynamically stable and ozone is thermodynamically unstable. So that is why, suppose if you supply the heat, the reaction is favorable to what? Backward reaction. So that is why, so this the above reaction del G value was positive. It confirms that this is a non-spontaneous. This is a non-spontaneous. How can you say it's a positive value? Just see that del H value already positive. Now del G is equal to del H minus T delta S. That is equal to del H value is how much? Del H value is a positive. And del S value, 3 moles are giving 2 moles. That means number of moles decreasing. Del S value was negative. Negative into negative, positive. So minus T delta S value is what? Positive. So that both the terms are positive, overall value is also positive. So the above conversion of O2 to O3, O2 to O3 is what? Non-spontaneous reactions. But supplying the heat is not favorable. So then how to convert the O2 to O3? So for that, they use silent electrical discharge. Okay, by doing the electrical discharge, slowly the O2 is converting into O3. And the instruments that they are using for the conversion of, for the preparation of ozone are called ozonizers. What we call them? Ozonizers. So, in this, Brodie's ozonizer is the best example, best instrument that we use to convert oxygen to ozone. And in this Brodie's ozonizer, only out of 100%, only 10% of oxygen is only converting into ozone. That means here, whatever the ozone that we are getting, okay, that we get only 10% of ozone. 10% is ozone, remaining 90% is what? O2 only. So this mixture we call it as what? Ozonized oxygen. That mixture we call it as what? Ozonized oxygen. But how to prepare pure ozone? Just liquefy. If you liquefy the ozonized oxygen, which liquid will liquefy first? Ozone will be liquefied. The remaining gas just separate out, and that liquid ozone we can get it from the liquefaction process. So this is how we prepare ozone in ozonizers. Okay, and after the preparation methods, then move to the properties of ozone. Properties of ozone. Remember that ozone, it can be used as oxidizing agent, reducing agent, and also bleaching agent. Oxidizing agent, reducing agent, bleaching agent. Oxidizing agent, if you see, when you compare the reactivity of ozone, remember that the reactivity of ozone is lesser than fluorine. When you compare the oxidizing nature of ozone with fluorine, fluorine is a strong oxidizing agent. It is lesser than fluorine, but greater than KMnO4, else H2O2. This is what order of reactivity of oxidizing agent. And how it is showing the oxidizing behavior? Simple. O3 converts into O2 by liberating nascent oxygen. And this nascent oxygen is responsible for the oxidizing nature of ozone. And if you see the oxidizing properties, here I am drawing few oxidizing properties. So what are those? It oxidizes lead sulfide to lead sulfate. Okay, and it oxidizes I minus to I2. And it oxidizes I minus in alkaline medium, alkaline I minus to IO3 minus. And it oxidizes sulfides to sulfates, nitrites to nitrates, and the sulfur dioxide to sulfur trioxide, arsenite AsO3 minus to AsO4 minus, and K4FeCN6 to potassium hexacetonferrate to K3FeCN6 means potassium hexacetonferrate means Fe plus 2 becomes Fe plus 3. Simply, ferrous ions are oxidized to what? Ferric ions. Okay, so these are, and one more thing, all the non-metal oxide means carbon into carbon dioxide and sulfur into sulfur dioxide and iodine into IO3 minus and phosphorus into P4 minus 3 phosphate. Like this, all the non-metals are converting into highest oxidation states. Like this, it is showing the oxidizing properties. Okay, but one point to remember, reducing properties, it will show only limited reducing properties. It will reduce barium peroxide into ozone. If you add, it will barium peroxide becomes barium. It will reduce the barium peroxide into barium. And silver oxide into silver. Only these two reducing behavior only it will show. And one more thing, bleaching action, I told, third property. They may ask you this question now. The bleaching action of ozone is because of its oxidizing behavior, reducing behavior, oxidizing behavior. Because of liberation of nascent oxygen, and that nascent oxygen will go on to bleach as well, colored substances into colorless substances. So the bleaching action is because of oxidizing behavior. But remember one point, if the bleaching action, almost all oxidizing agents will act as what? Bleaching agents. And a few reducing agents also will show its bleaching action. Best example, SO2. If the bleaching action is because of oxidizing behavior, then that bleaching action is a permanent. If the bleaching action is because of reduction, okay, reducing a property, then that is what? Temporary. Okay, here this is what? Oxidizing behavior. The bleaching action is because of oxidizing behavior. So, this is a permanent. Permanent. So, this is about the properties of
oxides of sulfur. So, in that the first one is sulfur dioxide. So, if you take the sulfur dioxide, it is almost showing the similarity with carbon dioxide. Let us see. And the properties, if you go, then you will differentiate the similarity of between SO2 and CO2. Let us start with the preparation methods of SO2. If you take the preparation methods, we can prepare the sulfur dioxide directly by the oxidation with oxygen, SO2. But there was a problem with this method. We cannot prepare SO2 in pure form by simply oxidation. Okay, why? Because during the preparation, there was a chances of getting 6 to 8% of SO3 also. So, if you wanted to prepare 100% of SO2, definitely we should not follow the first method. Then, the second method, you just take the sulfite salts. Okay, a sulfate salts. You just take SO4 minus. When sulfite salts on reaction with acids, like H plus ions. Okay, for example, you take 2H plus ions you take. If you add acids to the sulfite salts, sulfite molecules, sulfite, okay, Na2SO3, K2SO3, like that. When you add this, first we will get H2SO3, but H2SO3 is unstable like H2CO3. So, we will get H2SO3 same as like H2CO3. And is this H2CO3 is a stable one? No, immediately it will split into what? H2O and SO. CO3 splits into H2O and CO2. So similarly, H2SO3 also will splits into CO2. H2SO3 also will splits into H2O and SO2 gas. So it is showing the similarity with the carbonic acid. Next, and one more method of preparation of is you take the roasting method, roasting and calcination. So in roasting and calcination, what they do, roasting calcination we follow when we have roasting, especially when we have metal sulfates. For example, if you take iron, FeS2, to this if you add oxygen to this, so we will get Fe2O or Fe2O, and this sulfur will come out as what? SO2 gas. So during the roasting process, it's not balanced, just remember, iron sulfides are converting into what? Sulfur dioxide. This is in during roasting process, roasting the calcination, roasting only. And one more, fourth method, you can prepare this sulfur dioxide by treating sulfur, copper and silver with H2SO4. How can we get? Let us see. If we add sulfur to the H2SO4, H2SO4 is a strong oxidizing agent. It will oxidize the sulfur into what? Sulfur dioxide. So we get 2 moles of sulfur dioxide here. And here copper sulfate. Here 2 moles if you take, 1 mole will convert it into copper sulfate and another one will give out what? H2O and SO2. Similarly here also, 2 moles Ag2SO4, okay, and H2O and SO2 gas. Like this we can easily prepare SO2 by the addition of sulfur, copper, silver to sulfuric acid. So these are the methods of preparation of sulfur dioxide. Then move to the properties of sulfur dioxide. Sulfur dioxide usually react as what? Acid, as we know. Okay, like CO2. CO2 is also acid, right? So when CO2 is reacting with sodium hydroxide, we will get two types of salts. Same as like here also, when we add NaOH to this sulfur dioxide, we will get Na2SO3. If you further addition of H2O and SO2, if you further adding, we will get NaHSO3. So two different types of salts we are getting. One is a sulfide salts, another one is bisulfide salts, same as like CO2. Even CO2 also will form carbonate salts, bicarbonate salts. Same as like here also, sulfur dioxide will form two different types of salts. One is the sulfites, another one is bisulfites. Bisulfites also be called as hydrogen sulfides. So this is a reaction towards NaOH. And SO2 can act as oxidizing agent, reducing agent and also bleaching agent, as same as like ozone, but reducing agent is a dominating. And one more thing, this reducing action also in acidic conditions, this is a mild, it acts as a mild reducing agent in acidic media, but in basic media it is acting as a strong reductant, strong reducing agent. In acidic media mild, in basic media strong. And if you see the few reducing behavior, you take NaO4-. It reduces NaO4- into Mn+2 and the ferric ions into ferrous ions. Okay, and it reduces I2 into I-, and it reduces reducing properties. And one more thing, if you pass chlorine gas, SO2 reacts with chlorine, SO2 reacting with chlorine, we will get SO2Cl2. Similarly, when SO2 mix with PCl5, we will get SOCl2 and POCl3. Okay, SOCl2 and SO2Cl2. One point, in this case, SO2 is used to remove the chlorine. Okay, that is why SO2 we can use as anti-chlor. What is the meaning of anti-chlor? For example, if anywhere, if you wanted to remove the excess of chlorine, okay, just pass SO2. This SO2 will go and react with the chlorine and they forms SO2Cl2. And usually this is taking place in the presence of charcoal. Here one point you should remember. Suppose if you pass Cl2 directly to the SO2, you are getting SO2Cl2. Instead of Cl2, if you pass chlorine water means if you dissolve the chlorine gas in water, chlorine water, then we will get H2SO4. You may get a doubt. Why sir? Here when we send the chlorine gas to the SO2, we are getting SO2Cl2. But here H2SO2, how is it possible? Simple. Here what is the oxidation state of sulfur? Both are same. See that. In SO2Cl2, sulfur is the oxidation state +6. In H2SO4 is also +6. Same as in, or else you just hydrolyze this SO2Cl2, will get H2SO4 only. So both the products are same. So when you send only chlorine to the SO2, SO2Cl2 will come. If you pass chlorine water to the SO2, we are getting H2SO4. Products are different, but the process is same. Okay, now SO2 is used to remove the chlorine from the environment, so that we are using as anti-chlor. And one more thing, most important point, SO2 is showing the bleaching action. The bleaching action of SO2 is because of what? Its reducing nature, not because of its oxidizing nature. Because of its reducing nature, what is it? Is it permanent or temporary? Temporary. So it is a temporary, and during the reducing, if it is acting as a reducing agent, itself undergoes oxidation. So during this bleaching action, SO2 will come out as what? SO4-. So in the products, during the bleach, after the bleaching action, SO2 will come out as what? SO4-. So this is about the SO2, and if you check the structure of SO2 also, SO2, S double bond O having a lone pair, and what is the hybridization? It is undergoing sp2 hybridization and it is an angular or bent shape, and it has how many sigma pi bonds? It has two sigma bonds and two pi bonds, two sigma and two pi bond. And they may ask you that out of two pi bonds, how many p pi d pi overlapping and the d pi overlappings are there. It is undergoing sp2 mode. That means the center sulfur atom having one pure p orbital. So there was out of two pi bonds, one is formed by p pi d pi overlapping, another one is formed by d pi overlapping. Why? Because already one pure p orbital is there. That pure p orbital is involving in overlapping. So that one pi bond. So one pi bond is by p pi d pi overlapping, another one is by d pi overlapping. So this is about the SO2. Next, move to the oxy acids of sulfur. So in case of oxy acids of sulfur, generally sulfur will form four different types of oxy acids. Four types, but major types are two only, us and ink acids bases. And if you take the dioxides, EO2 and sulfur, na? So when SO2 on dissolution in water, we get H2SO3. So this is what acids are formed by the dissolution of sulfur dioxide. Next, sulfur trioxide, if you take H2O, we get H2SO4. So this name we call it as ic acid. So dioxides on hydrolysis, we get acid. Trioxides and hydrolysis, we get ic acids. In addition to this, sulfur also forms two different types. That is what? One is a thionic acid species, and one is a polyperoxy sulfuric acids. We will discuss. Total four types are there. One is acid series. The second one is ic acid series. And the third one is thionic acid series, and the fourth one is peroxy acid series. peroxyacids. Total four types of species are there, but on all these, one common point here you should remember this common point, that is in all these acids, the sulfur is always undergoes sp3 hybridization. That is the one common point. And all these oxy acids are dibasic. That means their basicity is 2. It's a fixed number. These 2 points are fixed for all these. Okay, let us discuss these acid series one by one. First of all, us acid series. In us acids, 4 acids will come. First one is sulfurous acid, also we call it as orthosulfurous acid. Why? Because this is formed by what? Dissolution or hydrolysis of sulfur dioxide. That is why orthosulfurous acid. So what is the chemical formula? The chemical formula will be H2SO3. And if you look at the structure, yes, double bond O, and I told you every sulfur, every acid having 2 OHs. Dibasic means 2 OH compulsory. So 1 OH, 1 OH, H2SO3, finish, no? So what is the oxidation state here? Oxidation state of this sulfur, -1, -1, -2, total plus 4 oxidation state. Clear? Next one, thiosulfurous acid. Thio means S double bond S linkage. There should be thionic acid, is different one. Thionic acid, that is different. Thio means S double bond S. So thiosulfurous acid means H2S2O2. If you look at the structure, OH is common, but in the place of S double bond O, what is there? S double bond S is there. That is the structure of thiosulfurous acid, H2S2O2. Now, here they'll ask you terminal, central, average oxidation states. Here, what is the terminal atom here? See, this sulfur atom is a central sulfur atom, and the remaining other sulfur atom is what? Terminal sulfur atom. So, terminal, it is bonding with double bond. If it is bonding with double bond, generally it is bonding with sulfur. So, what is that? -2 oxidation state. So, this is a -2 oxidation state. And coming to this sulfur, left side -1, right side -1, top -2, total -4. So this one is a +2, another one is this sulfur is a +2, and this sulfur atom is a +4. So first I am writing terminal +2 and a +4. Total overall average oxidation state is how much? +3 is the average. Central terminal. Understood? Terminal sulfur having +2 oxidation state. Central sulfur having -1, -2, -1. Overall neighboring oxidation states are -4, so itself having +4. So +2, +4. Average, how you will calculate? Sum of them and divide with the total number of atoms. +2, +4, +6. Total 2 sulfur atoms, +6 by 2, +3. Next, move to the third one, dithionous acid. Dithionous acid. So this is H2S2O4. So what is the structure of this one? OH, S double bond O, S double bond O, OH, H2S2O4. Okay, so this is thionous acid. How many are there? 2 are there. So that is a dithionous acid. So here both are central only. There was no. So one you can consider as a terminal, another one is considered as central. So if you take this one, left side -1, top -2, but right side same sulfur atom with a single bond. If it is single bond, no problem. If it is double bond only, we should consider like this. Here double bond S is there. That is why I am taking +2. But here it's a single bond. If it is bonded with a single bond, no need to take the oxidation number from that side. There was no polarity from that side. That is why from this side 0, from this side -1, top -2, total +3. So this is a +3, and the central is also +3. The average is also +3. Okay, and the fourth one, pyrosulfurous acid. This is also we call it as disulfurous acid. And already told you in the 5th A group elements, pyro means ortho plus ortho minus water. Just add 2 ortho and you subtract water from it, we'll get pi. That means 2 moles of H2SO3 minus water will get H2S2O5 will get. So that is the molecular formula of pyrosulfurous acid. And if you look at the structure, S double bond O, OH. What is the difference between this one and this one? H2S2O4, H2S2O5. So draw the same structure, but here you keep double bond O. At one sulfur atom, you keep double bond O. So this is a terminal and this is central. Central if you take, terminal if you take, minus 2, minus 1, plus 3 is the oxidation state of terminal. Coming to here, minus 2, minus 1, minus 2, 0. Plus 5 is the central oxidation state. Average is what? Plus 4. So this is what? Us acids. Us acids. Clear? Next, move to the ic acids. Ic acids. In these three acids will come. One is a sulfuric acid. Sulfuric acid. The structure, the formula is H2SO4. Double bond O, double bond O, OH. That is the structure. So minus 2, minus 2, minus 1, minus 1. Total plus 6 oxidation state. Next one, thiosulfuric acid. Thiosulfuric acid. So the structure will be H2S2O3. See, H2S2O2 is thiosulfurous acid. H2S2O3 is thiosulfuric acid. So this is OH, double bond O, double bond O, double bond S. Thio means double bond S. OH, H2S2O3. Okay, and this is a terminal. Terminal is minus 2, central is plus 6. Well, average is plus 2. Okay, minus 2 plus 6, plus 4. Plus 4 by 2, plus 2. Okay, this is thiosulfuric acid. And the next one, pyrosulfuric acid. Pyrosulfuric acid, pyros disulfuric acid. So this is also, we call it as what? Oleum. Oleum. Okay, so the structure is H2S2O7. This is the chemical formula, H2S2O7. And H2S2O7 means S double bond O, double bond O, OH. S double bond O, OH. H2S2O7. Okay. Now, there was an SOS linkage, pyrosulfuric acid, oleum having N1 SOS linkage. Now, central atom, both, one is a terminal, another one is a central, minus 2, minus 1, minus 2, and here this is the oxygen with single bond and minus 2 is having, but it's shared by two neighboring atoms. So, this side minus 1, this side minus 1. So, total plus 6, plus 6 to plus 6. And average is also plus 6. So, this is about the ic acid system. Next, thionic acids. Thionic acid series. In thionic acid series, two acids are there. One is dithionic. Dithionic acid. Dithionic acid formula H2S2O6. Here H2S2O7 came out. Here H2S2O6. If you see the structure, S double bond O, double bond O, S double bond O, double bond O, OH. OH. So that is the structure. So it's a combination of two thionic acids. So that is why we are calling it as a dithionic acid. Now, in this case, minus 1, minus 2, minus 2, 0 from this side. So total plus 5 oxidation state. Both are plus 5. Average is also plus 5. And the second one is polythionic acid. Polythionic acid. See, this is a dithionic acid. Why? Because there was a two sulfur atoms. That is the dithionic acid. Suppose poly means how you will write? See that same structure you draw, S double bond O, double bond O, S N, S double bond O, OH. Here, how many sulfur atoms are there? Many are there. That is the polythionic acid. So the chemical formula will be H2S2 plus N, okay, and H2S2O6. That is the chemical formula of polythionic acid. If you take this here, these are the two terminal sulfur atoms. Terminal sulfur atoms minus 2, minus 2, minus 1. Plus 5 is a oxidation state. And central is what? 0. Central sulfur atom, left side, right side, all are 0. But average oxidation state is very, very, very important now here. For example, what is the average oxidation state? What is the total oxidation state? This terminal atom having plus 5, this terminal atom having plus 5, total plus 10. But total how many sulfur atoms are there? N plus 2. So the average oxidation state is plus 10 by N plus 2. So by using this formula, you can calculate the average oxidation state. So this is about the thionic acids. And the last one, peroxy acids. In peroxy acid, the first one is a carboxylic, that is a H2SO5. This is what we call it as peroxy sulfuric acid. Peroxy sulfuric acid or peroxy monosulfuric acid. So this is also we call it as carox acid. Carox acid. Why we are calling it a peroxy acid? Because there was a one peroxy linkage, that is S double bond O, OH, OOH. So there was a one peroxy linkage. That is why we are calling it a carox acid. Next, oxidation states, if you see, sulfur atom, left side minus 1, right side minus 1, top, bottom, both are minus 2, minus 2. Total plus 6 oxidation state they have. Plus 6 oxidation state. Next, and the last one, peroxo disulfuric acid. Peroxy disulfuric acid. So, this is also we call it as Marshall's acid. Marshall's acid. And the chemical formula will be H2S2O8. Okay, you just connect the two sulfate units, you will get peroxy disulfuric acid. And this is the same you will get during the preparation of H2O2 in electrolytic method. Okay, so this is S double bond O, 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 S double bond O, OH, double bond O, OH. This is what we call it as Marshall acid. Oxidation states on both sides are plus 6 plus 6. Okay, this is about the oxy acids of sulfur. Oxidation state of thiosulfuric acid, I made a small mistake. Man. Thiosulfuric acid, this is the structure H2S2O3. So the terminal sulfur having plus 2 oxidation state, central having minus 1, minus 1, minus 2, minus 2. Total minus 6 is the neighboring oxidation state, so itself having plus 6. Plus 2 plus 6 plus 8 by 2 plus 4 will come. Okay, please note down this point. Next, move to the sulfuric acid. In the oxy acids, we need to discuss on sulfuric acid, H2SO4. King of acids. We generally call H2SO4 as king of acids. Next, in this preparation methods, the main method of preparation of sulfuric acid is what? Contact process. Contact process. So what are the steps in a contact process? The first step one is roasting of sulfide ores. FeS2 on roasting we get what? SO. Either roasting, okay, or else S plus O2 gives rise to SO. Any one of this, anyhow, sulfur is oxidizes to what? SO2 is the first step. Next, in the second step, what is that? SO2 on further oxidation, okay, we are getting SO3, but this is a reversible reaction. Here we will use a vanadium pentoxide. Vanadium pentoxide is a catalyst. So this is del H value was negative. Spontaneous reaction. Okay, what are the optimum temperature, optimum conditions here? Optimum conditions are, okay, here del H value was negative. Negative means low temperatures are favorable, but at low temperature the reaction is very 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 slow. So generally we will maintain optimum temperature, that is around 700 kelvins of temperature we will maintain here. And coming to the pressure, if you see the pressure, 3 moles of reactants giving 2 moles now. Means higher number of moles giving lesser number of moles. Number of moles decreasing means high pressures are favorable. But as per the Le Chatelier principle, high pressure is favorable for the above reaction. But we should maintain very less temperature, is what? 2 atmospheric pressure only we will maintain. What is the reason? If you maintain the high pressure conditions, because of oxidizing behavior of SO2, okay, there was a rust formation takes place. But wherever the in which vessel we are doing this process, that vessel may rust and it may damage. That is why we should maintain less pressures only, even though high pressures are favorable. Okay, so that is the optimum conditions for the second step. Next, in the third step, what will happen? Now the formed SO3, it will dissolve it in H2SO4. So that we are getting H2S2O7. This is what we call it as what? Oleum. Oleum. Thereafter, this oleum on further hydrolysis, we are getting 2 moles of H2SO4. You may get the doubt. If SO3 on direct hydrolysis, on direct hydrolysis, we'll get H2SO4, na? Then why don't we do this? We should not directly dissolve SO3 in water. Why? Because if you directly dissolve SO3 in water, okay, it suddenly liberates a huge amount of energy. That means there is a chances of explosion here. To avoid that, we should not directly dissolve SO3 in the water. Of course, we can get the H2SO4, but there was a chances of explosions. That is why first we should dissolve in H2SO4 and making oleum. Thereafter, dissolution of that oleum in the water, we get H2SO4. So this is the steps we are following in contact process. Next, we move on to properties of H2SO4. Properties. In that acidic character. In this asthma, H2SO4 is in a strong acid. And here, H2SO4, it will release 1H plus ions and whose Ka1 value, and HSO4 minus further releases H plus and they forms SO4 minus 2. Here Ka1 and Ka2. When you compare the Ka1 and Ka2, Ka1 is always larger than Ka2. First, the releasing of first proton is easier than second proton. And that is why because of two protons releasing, it will form two types of salts. Two type of salts they can produce when they react with the bases. What are the salts they produce? One is sulfate salts, another one is bisulfate salts. Two types of salts they produce when they are treated with bases. That is the first acidic character. Next one, after the acidic character, the H2SO4 also acting as a dehydrating agent. Dehydrating agent. Dehydrating agent means what? Suppose if whenever and wherever if you wanted to remove the water, eliminate the water, they can use H2SO4. Why? Because H2SO4 having the high affinity towards water. That is why. So, for example, you just take dehydrating, suppose copper sulfate 5H2O you take. Copper sulfate. Okay, 10H2O. Sorry. Okay, and hydrated copper sulfate. To this hydrated copper sulfate, if you add concentrated H2SO4, then it becomes what? Anhydrous copper sulfate. So, hydrated copper sulfate becomes what? Anhydrous. Similarly, you take sugar, that is C12H22OLED. Okay, sugar. So, to this sugar, if you add concentrated H2SO4, we will get 12 carbons and this water molecules, this remaining gas will eliminate as water. That means this is what we call black color. This process only we call it as charring of sugar. That means if you take the spatula, in the spatula by taking a small amount of sugar to this, if we add H2SO4 concentrated, then that H2SO4 will become, that sugar crystals become black in color. After it loses the water molecule, the sugar becomes what? Black in color. So this process we call it as what? Charring of sugar. Even this is also based upon dehydrate. And one more thing, if you take formic acid, HCOOH, to this if you add H2SO4, it will give H2O and liberates which gas? Carbon monoxide. Suppose if you take oxalic acid, COOH, H2C2O4, this is oxalic acid. To this if you add H2SO4, we will get H2O, CO and CO2, very 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 important. Formic acid will liberate only carbon monoxide, whereas oxalic acid will liberate mixture of carbon monoxide and hydroxide. And one more beautiful example, that is what, if you add H2SO4 to this structure, what is this? Naphthalene structure. Okay, what we expect now, if we add concentrated H2SO4, what do you expect? We will get a thallic acid. Thallic acid is a ring. One ring will break and we will get thallic acid. So, this is about dehydration of properties of H2SO4. okay, and not only the dehydrating agent, and also we use it as a drying agent, and we also use this as a drying agent also. Drying agent. So to convert the moist gases into dry gases, we use H2SO4 as a drying agent. Drying agent for which gases? Especially for nitrogen and for oxygen and for fluorine, okay, for SO2, etc. For these all gases, okay, we will use this H2SO4 as a drying agent. And one more thing, it is used as a strong oxidizing agent. H2SO4 is an oxidizing agent. But comparatively, when you compare with other acids like HNO3, H2SO4, H3PO4, this is the order of reactivity. When you compare these acids, nitric acid is a strong oxidizing agent, then H2SO4, then H2SO4 is a strong oxidizing agent, then phosphoric acid. This is the order of reactivity. And if you see, it will oxidize carbon into carbon dioxide, sulfur into sulfur dioxide, copper into Cu+2. Like this general oxidation states, it will show. Okay, so this is about the sulfuric acid. I hope this 16th group elements, this concept is clear to you. I hope I covered almost all important points in this. In addition to this, please go through the NCERT book. Okay.